Interlude by Swat Jester. In the reign of Verviticus the Minor, our noble fort received a large influx of migrants from some strange fortress called Cuba. Naturally, the first thing they did before getting to work as trash haulers was to hold the first goblin baseball game.
Fuck yeah, Holmes.
And Dirty Deeds Done steps up to the plate. He has had a relatively stable offensive average this year with a .278 batting average and a .714 goblin slugging percentage. And it's out of here! An upper decker! Dirty Deeds Done connecting on a solid curveball with a huge homer in the bottom of the ninth! The Dwarves win the pennant! The Dwarves win the pennant! The Dwarves win the pennant! Meanwhile, the Dwarven sports season was moving into full swing, with Verviticus kicking off the frozen river ice skating season.
It's way less scary, and I can dress up in my princess costume.
Unfortunately, by allowing the water supply to freeze for his figure skating princess fantasies, Verviticus ineptly caused the death of two of his fellow citizens, who were too unimportant to name here.
Oh, hey!
Wounded in a freak nude wrestling accident, too gruesome to mention with young dwarven ears around, the two meaningless, worthless, unimportant...
Okay, we got it already!
Ahem. As I was saying, their mangled bodies lay on the ground, yet with no water to treat them, they quickly died of thirst. Great job, Verviticus. Great job.
Verviticus breaks out in tears.
With that, the reign of Verviticus the Minor ended, only to be replaced by that of Kippling, the evangelical preacher.
I say, I pray for the future of this fort.
Year 4. The Rule of Kippling. Excerpt from the Diaries of Brother Kippling, Midwinter, 108.
The past few months of preparation had been very successful. High Bishop Walleran was delighted with the condition of the monastery during his visit. We've achieved so much since I first arrived here. No longer is the priory run down and forgotten. With the Lord's favor, we have turned this place around. People travel for days to see the relics, and the collection bins are overflowing with donations.
Late Winter, 108.
A letter for Bishop Walleran arrived today. In light of the newfound wealth and success of the priory, he's chosen to reward me with a new opportunity to serve the Lord. Saints be praised. Enclosed in the letter was a map and directions to the distant outpost called Headshoots. I have been instructed to travel there as soon as possible to ensure the light of the Lord stretches to the new frontier. The bishop ensures me that the priory will be well taken care of during my absence. He's sending his personal treasurer here to administrate and to ensure the donations are used to further the works of the Lord. My heart is filled with joy at the prospect of finding a new flock. I will prepare for the journey at once.
Early Spring, 109.
I can finally see the peaks of the mountain ahead, but the journey has been harder than I ever imagined. This place is bleak. The stench of sulfur fills the air, and the treeless landscape is battered by harsh winds. I have this terrible feeling I'm being watched, so I have prayed for the Lord's divine protection. As soon as I've composed myself, I will set off for the final stretch of the trek. When I arrive, I must find the strength to bring the light of the Lord here. I hope I've not arrived too late.
Excerpt from the Diaries of an Unknown Peasant, Early Spring, 109. On our last hauling addition into the wilderness, I found a traveler, wearing what looked like monk's habits, lying face down between two boulders. He was caked from head to toe in what seemed to be dwarven excrement. Lying next to him was the raw, half-consumed corpse of the kitten that disappeared yesterday. We took him inside and cleaned him up a bit. Unfortunately, there was an accident on the way back in, and Monkette was crushed to death by the main drawbridge. We're not going to tell the monk right away. He seems mentally fragile enough as it is. Excerpt from the diaries of Brother Kippling, Early Spring, 109.
The traditional protective ward failed. I awoke today within the fort, and I consider myself lucky to be alive. The storm came in too fast, and I lost my way. Luckily, the Lord chose to provide me with a delicious native animal to keep me fed throughout the night. I had a look around the fort, and they are impressively wealthy. They even have a masterwork adamantium tomb outside the main entrance for a dwarf called Verticus.
Excerpts from the diaries of Brother Kipling, Midspring, 109.
The fortress truly is the only light in this wasteland. Fearsome demons and the undead stalk the valleys outside, but I must be strong. The dwarves here have long been away from the teachings of the Lord, and I must show them back to the light. Last week, a dwarf produced a truly legendary piece of craft dwarfship, a crown worth 600,000 of the local currency. However, I'm unnerved by it. Upon it is an image of a wave that has appeared in my dreams, along with my own death.
Excerpts from the diaries of an unknown engineer. Early Spring, 109.
With the departure of the elven caravan and the construction of the crown, everything is in place. Construction begins tomorrow.
This is a raw adamantine crown. All craft dwarfship is of the highest quality. It is encircled with bands of raw adamantine, tower cap, and turtle shell. This object menaces with spikes of basalt, white opal, and tower cap. On the item is an image of Saxul Lantern Anguish, the dwarf, and dwarves in red zircon. Saxul Lantern Anguish is surrounded by the dwarves. The artwork relates to the ascension of the dwarf Saxul Lantern Anguish to leadership of the Pulley of Freckles in 10. On the item is an image of a wave in steel. Excerpt from the diaries of an unknown peasant, Late Spring, 109.
Another wave of immigrants arrived, along with a dungeon master. God help them. Their cows spontaneously combusting on the way in is a bad omen.
From the diaries of Brother Kipling, Early Summer, 109.
Humans! I've never seen one before.
Sweet mercy, they're ugly. At least they brought goods to trade. Their broker brought a large quantity of wood, beer, and hundreds of turtles. I suppose he has his reasons. I'm glad for the warriors. I feel much safer with them near the gate. The mayor has had the good sense to ramp up food and alcohol production and to install new bedrooms. We've got enough room and production capacity for twice our numbers now.
Excerpt from Brother Kipling, Midsummer, 109.
The fort is in chaos, and I detect foul play. Goblins have ambushed a hauler near the edge of our lands. Many dwarves, myself included, ran outside to try and gather the remaining material left over from the last fight before the goblins had time to reach the main gate. The ground is soaked with a mixture of vomit and blood. Sedge Cube, one of the garbage dwarves, took advantage of the chaos by proclaiming the current Mayor Frog incompetent and suggesting himself as a replacement. A truly opportunistic move. Frog refused to give up his room, and it remains his, despite the displeasure of our new garbage dwarf mayor. Sedge's cube Catalnitig, garbage dwarf, has been elected mayor. From the diaries of an unknown engineer, Midsummer, 109.
The panic during the goblin ambush provided the perfect cover for the first test. I've confirmed the pumps are working correctly and the flow rate is sufficient, so we can proceed to the next phase. The second project is underway, and we've begun to make good progress. The well will prove invaluable.
From the diaries of an unknown engineer, Midsummer, 109.
A foolish dwarf managed to find his way into the upper chamber, along with a stray kitten. It's too early for everybody to find out, and he must not be allowed to speak of what he has seen. Now would be as good a time as any to run the next test.
The trade depot floods with magma.
catching a dwarf.
Bembul Ilungeshud, Kitten, has bled to death. Febreze Ninja Zulbanfath, Hauler, has died in the heat.
Excerpts from the Diary of Brother Kipling, Midsummer, 109.
Joyous news! Another artifact has been created, a bejeweled animal trap. Some of the other dwarfs scoff at its meager value of 4,200, but I see it as one of the few beacons of civilization in this godforsaken land.
This is a Prace animal trap. All Crafts dwarfship is of the highest quality. It is encrusted with Prace. From the Diaries of Brother Kipling, Late Summer 109.
Lord preserve us! We've been attacked once again. Darien, our hunter, was taken by surprise by goblins. He received an arrow to the heart before having his legs ripped off. He bled to death alone in the wastes. It was a terrible thing to see. In the rush to retrieve his body before it could be defiled, almost the entire population of the fort ran outside before the military could react. Three others were injured, and I do not expect them to survive the next season. Argle Bargle III took an arrow. Alias had an arm and a leg mangled, and Ska received a chest wound. When the military arrived, Dirty Deeds Done and Holistic Detective were frenzied like true holy warriors. They ripped apart the invaders, splitting them into chunks with sword and axe. The carnage they created was unlike any other. Chunks of goblins strew the landscape, floating in vast pools of blood and soaked equipment. A long track of vomit creates a slippery path between the gate and the battlefield, by the dwarves sickened by the sunlight and the corpses. Even now, bits of goblin, dwarf, and general wreckage slip down into the opening of the northeastern magma pipe on a sheet of half-digested plump helmets and gore.
From the Diaries of an Unknown Engineer, Early Autumn, 109.
The new well has been completed, together with the adaptions to the new rooms for the nobles. The construction of the Doomsday device is entering the final stage.
From the Diaries of Brother Kipling, Mid-Autumn, 109.
A cloud of depression overshadows the fort. The three injured dwarves are slowly dying of thirst, unable to rise from their beds. I hope their suffering ends soon. More pets have mysteriously combusted, including a dog and several cats. The purchase of gems from a caravan lifted the spirits of a few, even inspiring another legendary artifact said to be worth 600,000. But the daily struggle for survival has taken its toll on morale. My own mind keeps wandering back to the image of a wave carved on the spooky crown. My sleep has been disturbed by the sounds of digging behind the walls. I'm not aware of any new workshops being created, so I think I'm going to investigate.
This is a raw adamantine scepter. All Crafts dwarfship is of the highest quality. This object menaces with spikes of raw adamantine. Alias Keshok Shazir, pump operator, has died from thirst. Ska Gabarlogan, Hauler, has died from thirst. Argle Bargle III Kivishitan, animal caretaker, has died from thirst. From the Diaries of an Unknown Engineer, Early Winter, 109.
The dwarf Kipling knows too much. He must be stopped before he finds out about the Doomsday device. Perhaps now's the time to test the new bedroom.
Excerpts from the Diary of Brother Kipling, Midwinter, 109.
It seems my efforts have earned me the right to a decent bedroom. I'll move my things over there right away.
No! No, Swatchester! Swatchester, no!
Swatchester pulls the lever. The bedrooms flood with water. Brother Kipling, Tilesh Kubuk, preacher, has drowned. Excerpts from the Diary of an Unknown Engineer, Late Winter, 109.
The Doomsday device has been completed, and the magma pumping is proceeding at full speed. At the current rate of extraction, the device will be ready to be triggered during early spring.
Out of character note. The Doomsday device, I think, needs to be seen to be appreciated properly.
I can't really make screenshots because it's too damn big. It's essentially a magma waterfall generator. A new underground 3-6 tile wide magma river stretches from the northeast corner of the map all the way round to the southwest corner of the fort, rising up 7 Z levels using a chain of screw pumps. The magma river drains into a roughly 20 by 30 sized chamber located immediately to the west of the gate and to the trade depot. On the outside wall, facing south, there are 2 adamantium floodgates equipped with adamantium mechanisms connected to levers on the inside. When the upper magma chamber is fully filled, it will be capable of flooding roughly 4,200 tiles with fiery death every shot. It should be able to reload in about 1 minute of real time, assuming the lower chambers are full. However, there are some drawbacks. The lower chambers take about 9 months game time to refill, and I've no idea where the magma will actually flow when it's released. It could potentially flood the entire fortress, killing everybody. Also, care will need to be taken when digging channels now. There's plenty of room to expand over and under the new rivers, but I think care needs to be taken. Possibly walls could be added to the outside of the fortress to direct the flow, but that's up to the next guy. Personally, I like the random hit-and-miss element. Another thing to consider might be to redirect the river to clean up the mess after it's been used. On the bottom level, I've built a few rooms for the nobles and the rich people. Each room backs into a water sluice for the new well, and every room has a floodgate linked to a lever outside the door. If any nobles start making unreasonable demands, or otherwise causing stress, they can be easily drowned while they sleep, at the expense of a few muddy tiles, or potentially flooding the bottom levels of the fort if the doors are wedged open. There's a ton of food and drink and some new bedrooms, but not much more. The military has shrunk to 7 after one of the deaths. There's no new weapons and bugger all for iron and steel. I used it all to build the pumps and whatnot. And nothing really left to trade.